All right. So welcome everyone to this another session of CybInCync, which is a podcast series where we talk about different industries and verticals. We take opinions from our experts and the leaders from the industry about what the current trends are, about where the industry is going, about what the disruptions are, what are the decisions to be taken, and ultimately what is the direction to go forward. You know, today we are fortunate to have John Piccone as one of the panelists for the session. Hi, John, welcome to the CybInCync. Today we'll continue to talk about attention economy, which is very relevant of a topic when it comes to media and advertisement industry. Advertising is not something that is new. It has been there from the almost from the prehistoric times, where the whole purpose of it is to get attention from the users, right? Over the years, the way to do it has changed. The way user pay attention has changed, and the industry has kind of aligned to it with the help of different technologies. And a good representation of that is what we've seen in the past decade or so, you know, where data science has kind of made its presence felt. Data gathering has made its presence felt, and the decisions that we take based on the data has really driven the industry to come at, basically get that tiny little vital piece of user attention where, the brands get noticed. So while all of this is happening, while technology is kind of playing its role in ensuring that the right decision points are thrown out for the experts to kind of pick from, it has also opened a different box of Pandora. It's like one of them, which we've seen off late being very relevant is the data abuse, where intentional or not intentional data is being used for the purposes which is not relevant or which is not agreed upon by the users, the results that come out of the usage of the data are not really something that users would really happily accept. This is going to be the center of the conversation today. And before we jump there, a quick introduction about John. I don't think we need a separate introduction for John. Anybody who's in the media industry, they know John as a very seasoned leader from the industry. He has led quite a lot of initiatives in his previous careers. Currently he works as a president for the Adform, which is a big innovation centerpiece in itself for the industry. And of course, John is a very good friend of Cybage. So thank you, John, again, for joining us today and taking the time out, from your busy schedule to talk about, how data has kind of shaped up the overall industry and what we need to kind of focus upon going ahead from here onwards.
Thank you for having me.
Sure. So let's kick off this conversation by talking about data abuse. Do you really think that brands can use the data as effectively without actually abusing it?
Well, firstly, if we take a step back and we talk about what is the value of the data. There needs to be a value exchange between us as consumers and the principals with whom we engage. And for the purposes of this example, I would define a principal as anybody that has produced content, a publisher, if you will, whose product is to engage a consumer, and then therefore has created an environment for an advertiser, in this case, to also engage alongside that partnership with the publisher. And so there needs to be that value of content, and therefore exchange, that's also implicitly explained to the consumer that, right, hey, was this a fair exchange? Did I give you something? And I'll recognize that by the amount of time that you're spending with me over time, in which we agree that I'll probably know more about you over time. And then it's the advertiser's responsibility to say, my products align with this particular engagement that you've chosen, Mr. and Mrs. Consumer. And now with one click, you can come on over to my environment, to me as a principal, where there's a different type of value exchange. I think where the noise in the system is where there has been intermediaries and third-party proxies who have used this for different purposes other than the primary principals and their value exchange. Right. So I don't think it's we need to look at the full picture of not just the marketer, but the sources of content in which marketers engage with, who also right. have a part of the value exchange, and therefore the data right. sharing.
Right. And that's a very good point, John. And in the sense, it depends on who the self-interests of all the players in the overall ecosystem is kind of different. The user would have a different interest. The brand are definitely self-interested because they want to sell their products to the users, right? And then we have all the intermediaries, as you spoke about. For them, their value into the system is a little different than what is there to the next immediate consumer, you know?
Exactly.
So when the data actually progresses in all these, you know, line of exchanges or all the stream of different, producers and the consumers, do you think the kind of problems that have come out very recently is about maintaining the privacy of the data, right? Or maintaining, or basically, how do you preserve the identity of the people who are actually within the ecosystem, you know, from the overall value exchange standpoint? So, how do you see industry changing gears to align to this, changing values and the changing kind of, expectations from these particular parameters?
Well, in addition to the value exchange between the principals and the third parties, we've entered into a paradigm in which the connective tissue are these either social media platforms or these, lack of a better term, platforms that have a responsibility to connect all parties. And their role of being the owners of the data set is new to our industry. We've always had third-party clearinghouses, but third-party clearinghouses that have a responsibility to declare what they know about people versus what they hold on to themselves is where right. we're in new territory.
Right.
And I think that we are in this new journey of understanding, well, who is responsible for mining this data, and what are their repercussions if they don't mine it properly? And this is where government plays a very big role. And we're seeing here in the United States that the states are being the most active by drafting legislation to really try and clean up the world, or the data world, I should say, in this context. And we're starting to see litigation take place, California being the leading state with their CCPA initiative. And they're starting to actually activate that law that's been in place now for 2 years.
Yeah, and I think it's going to continue on that line as well, right? And majority of the states will fall in line. I think the whole concept started back in Europe, where people kind of stood up and said that we don't really want our data to be shared, unless we really want it to be shared. But this poses a different challenge for the brands, right? I mean, earlier the effort was to collect as much data as possible. There were means, there were, dollars invested, there were money invested in kind of ensuring that no matter what, every interaction with the users is translated into a data point, and we have that with us so that we can make informed decisions going on, and we can leverage that data, to get that again, the small piece of attention, or basically make impact whenever there's an engagement with the user. So don't you think it's a problem of having plenty right now? I mean, people who have data, I mean, they just probably don't know how to make best use of it under that regulatory system that everybody is kind of going towards?
I think the intent of what to do with it has been relatively pure. The purpose of, I need to sell more of my products through this data, I don't think that's ever changed. Right. I think where the complexity comes in is marketers have to deal with so many different types of signals in right. which the picture is not as colorful as they would like it to be. So they deal with a lot of proxy data, right? Data that comes through media, display, video, search. They have data that's coming off of their website. They have email pixels. They have event tags. There's control tags on their site. Then they have everything that's happening on the mobile apps, the mobile web. So imagine you're sitting back and you're seeing all of these different data signals coming in, and there's no one source of truth of who these particular individuals are, because the platforms themselves are fragmented. and there's no one owner. So we see now the consolidation of these notions of walled garden, in which they say, hey, I know the most about your users, and I know the most about your users. Yeah. And the brand is saying, well, wait a second, are they your users or are they mine? So there's not even a, there's two things happening. There's who is the rightful owner of a consumer or a prospect, for what purpose? And then therefore, how can that be brought to bear of cleaning up the signals? And I think what's happening right now is that's the next couple of years. We've entered into a stage of first party identification through, you know, consumer data platform CDPs, which is requiring data clean rooms that are actually the way in which we can make sure that privacy safeguards are put in place, all to build a unified profile.
Right. Yeah, and I think as you mentioned, I mean, there are disparate systems or disparate owners in this ecosystem, right? And the whole, while the intent is quite pure, you know, maintaining that privacy of you know, of the you know, entities in the whole ecosystem is kind of vital. But at the same time, while the privacy is maintained, the another important piece of it is transparency, right? Where we speak about what, why am I actually taking your details and what am I going to do with it? That it might be different if there is a direct consumer to the user or the brand to the consumer conversation, but it becomes difficult when we have so many intermediaries in the value chain, right? So what are your thoughts on that? I mean, is there really a good way to maintain privacy, or what we see people do, what I meant was, is there really a good way to maintain transparency in this whole exchange of data points from time to time? Is it really possible? Or if it is?
I think it has to be possible. I think we will lose the trust and confidence of the consumers if we don't show them how the value exchange is in their benefit. Mm-hmm. And if we take a step back, I think as we're looking through the lens of marketing objectives, a brand has different stages of its growth. Mm-hmm. And not overnight is a brand available in retailers across the country. They have to work their way up the food chain. And the way to do that is to create the mental awareness in their target consumer set, then followed by the actual physical availability of their product so that consumer can go get it. And that physical availability could be just going to an Amazon or some other retailer, e-commerce retailer, or it could be a physical availability down the street. And so how do I get a consumer to know that my product exists and that there's value to that consumer? And can I afford to actually waste money to get new audiences who I don't know are my target audience? And that's where you see the actual changes, where we've gone from a mass media up marketplace, from everything from newspapers to then radio to then television, and then to now a micro media marketplace. And how do those two things work in tandem?
Right.
That's what marketers have to struggle with. Where am I in my brand growth, to the extent of how much money I have to spend, to what I need to prove to my product developers that we're building the right product.
Right. Makes sense. And I think, you know, the funnels that you spoke about, I mean, the awareness funnel, where we have the mass media, channels where we just speak about the brand and where brands kind of publish themselves and make sure that people remember them, to a point where the funnel narrows down to a point where there is a focused effort of engagement with the consumers. But in the whole, in this kind of conversion of the mass segment to the targeted segment, there is still, you know, the data still plays a very vital role, right? In the sense, you know, the kind of filtering down, there are different products, and the kind, you know, a very important piece of it is what you mentioned is the credibility, right? So whatever the message that I'm passing out, whether how credible I am in passing that message out to my users, so that I tell them that, hey, you need a particular category of product, but what you need right now is my product, and this is why, you know? So in that whole, and again, previously it was a very focused effort was on, you know, just the fact that you make the product more, you know, more visible. You kind of hammer that message onto the users, and users kind of, there's more likely chance that people would remember when they are going out and buying that category of the product, right? Now that whole paradigm is kind of changing in terms of letting every individual know that why you should get my product, as opposed to somebody else who's doing the similar thing, maybe at a different cost or maybe at a different value proposition. So do you feel that data has been a central driver for this particular change in the approach of, you know, how the funnel conversion happens from the top layer to the bottom layer?
Absolutely. It's just how blunt of an instrument are they using to measure the value of that value exchange. So we have to remember that the consumers are very fickle. Okay. They it's hard to get them to be loyal to a brand. And when they are loyal to a brand, we shouldn't be marketing to them anymore because it's wasted dollars. But that's a very small percentage of the consumer set. And so we have to remind them that there is value in my product, and here is what that is. And you get into pricing of that value as compared to your competitive landscape to make sure that you're either number one or number two, because consumers forget sometimes about which one they should try, or which one was good, or I'll try this. And so you're always stealing share from your competitors. So that's the other angle that we need to get into this is, how is my competitor doing? How am I doing? Right. And what can I, what is my value exchange against my competitor to my consumer? And when will the consumer make their next purchase? So behind all of this, through these customer data platforms, through you name all of the proxy metrics that we talked about, like, are people clicking on my banner? Are they spending time watching my videos? Are they spending time on my own website? You're then building personal data relationships, right, with trying to build the segments. And I have to have my whole CRM system, and I have a loyalty system, and then I have all my purchase data. Sometimes I don't have the purchase data. I have to rely on the retailer to send me the purchase data. And that's obfuscated in a way that I can't really see what, you know, the real value is of what I'm selling, when, and how it correlates to all the other different signals. Right. But before this, we have to know what the problem is before we can solve it. And we haven't had this problem before because we haven't had so many signals. Right. So I think that the tried and true models of looking and taking a step back and looking at periods of time that are larger, so you can start to see the trends as it relates to the 12 months of the year, the holidays that are in the season in those 12 months, where weekends have an impact on sales. All of these are also indicators of how a consumer engages with a brand. How that data then kicks out, and there's a funny expression out there I heard once is, you know, terabytes of data and kilobytes of insight, but that doesn't happen overnight.
True. That's absolutely true. And, you know, by the end of it, I guess, as a user, I mean, the whole, we are in this situation where we have to think about legal and, you know, regulatory means, because the users have certain, you know, they've felt that, you know, they're being just used as, you know, their information is being used as a measure to kind of reach, or basically for somebody else's interest rather than their own. Right. So how do you think users are going to react to all of this? In the sense, what we are trying to kind of establish here is different ways of being, you know, sympathetic about what others feel about their information, and how, you know, how we target them or how we use their data. But we have seen this pattern where somebody being okay with it or not knowing about it kind of starts, you know, reacting differently when they come to know about the fact that their data is being used and their data is being shared. Basically, when there is more transparency in the whole area. How do you think this is going to go from here onwards from the user standpoint? I mean, so basically from the open advertising world where anybody and everybody could reach out to you and you were available as a, a programmatic bid for most of the, advertisers. Now we have come to a point where it is you who decide what kind of, you know, advertisements you would like to see, or basically whether you would even want to be out there in the market or otherwise, you know. Where do you think it is going to go from the user standpoint? One of the things that it has taken out from the users is the options that they would otherwise get, the advertisement that they would otherwise see, and this kind of limited them to probably their interest if they're open to even seeing the advertisements. But do you think it's going to go to a point where, again, we go back to not having enough advertisements? if we continue on this path for like, you know, more than a few years from here onwards?
I think that consumers need a better activation tool or a data wallet in which is very simple for them to use. I don't think that they're going to make the effort to measure and monitor the usage of their behaviors in the digital world. I think it's just too much of an ask for how much is going on in people's lives. And I think that fundamentally, human behavior is very hard to change. That said, the different generations of human behavior are different. So people who are in their 60s and above is different than people who are 12 to 24. And that value exchange continues to be shaped by the time spent on the various devices. So when you have initiative by Apple to say, do not track, right? On third parties, mind you, doesn't mean that Apple can't track you, right? They're just saying third parties can, which is a business decision, but they're putting it through the window of this is privacy focused for you, consumer. Right. And they've made it very, very simple. And we see the impact that that's had on Facebook's earnings, on different, you know, Meta's earnings, and what other companies that rely on that ability to track. And was the value exchange different to the consumer? I think it's too early to say. If you do turn off your cookies and you say do not track, and you see the banners and the ads that are delivered to you, they're often not very relevant.
Yep.
And this is what we're gonna go through. And we need to have the sway of the needle go back and forth to then pick a point of time to say, that's when that happened, and this was the impact. And it's the marketer to understand, well, that's what it did to my sales.
True.
And I don't think that we'll ever see a day in which marketers will aggregate the information that they know about their consumers in order to have a privacy safe world, because it's just too competitive.
True.
And I think that's what's gonna hold us back, is the natural laws and tension of competition will prohibit us from actually creating a ubiquitous data wallet, if you will, in a way that says, no, I know more about my consumer, so I'm gonna sell more products, and that's my right.
Absolutely. And if you really look at it, John, I mean, we are here because of technology, right? Are we not? In the sense, we started collecting data because we thought we need data in order to be more targeted, in order to have more sales, in order to have more that personal connections with the users. So over past, I don't know how many years, we started collecting data points. We kind of have those unique visitors and, you know, unique profile concept going on. We started building that by means of data. There were tons of platforms and tools which were put in, you know, billions of dollars invested in that effort. Now we are at a point where it is creating a sort of, you know, something that we, you know, it's creating, probably in the simplest term, it is creating another problem for us to solve. And our solution again is technology. I mean, we have those consent platforms, we have really those means in which we can, really be, or at least appear to be, more transparent and more aligned to the user's interest and all of that. So where do you classify technology in this whole equation? Do you think it as a problem creator, or do you think it as a problem solver?
I think the owners of the technology, if we can personify technology, I think that the general feeling is that they are impatient. And they always want to make things better because they can. Same idea, why'd you climb the mountain? Because it's there.
Yeah.
Their initiative to always make things better is inherent in the build of the technology. Now they need to make things better as compared to what? And so you need to pick a time frame in which I'm going to say, I can improve this a little bit more, which will cause this outcome. I think the biggest force in the ecosystem that causes change is probably government regulation, because they can actually enforce it, and once penalties hurt your business, including prison sentences, that makes people react differently, and it slows down the train. So that tension between government regulation and the impatience of technology is where we find progress. And it's never at the speed that a government can move. So you're always going to have technology pushing the envelope faster than government can regulate it. Yeah. And then the lawsuits then bring technology back.
Backwards.
And I think that natural tension will continue as long as you and I are talking and people like us.
Very true, very true. And but by the end of the day, I mean, we talked about interest, you know, at the beginning of our conversation, and we all understand that every entity in this ecosystem has a different interest because of which they are in this ecosystem, right? And we have now technologies over the period of time which are grown to address those particular interests. Can there really be a common interest? I mean, from the brand standpoint, it's very simple, like you mentioned. I just want to sell my products to you because they are more relevant to you. And I just want to find out whether it is more relevant to you or otherwise. From the consumer standpoint, the interest is very simple. I need to know about something when I need to know about something, right? Other than that, probably, you know, the one left extreme is that don't bother me unless I want some more information to know about. The right extreme is that, hey, look, I'm an open book. This is what I do. Tell me what you do. If there is a synergy, then let's, you know, move ahead and let's speak about it, you know. So between these two extremes, there are entities which trying to push you towards one way or the other by kind of giving you different insights and giving you different data points and also giving you different ramifications of the data. So do you really think there can be a common line of interest in the entire ecosystem of advertising at all, given the fact that at every point in time, the consumers and the producers change, and also the kind of value that you bring to the table also changes. In a sense, if you talk about the social platforms, right? For them, their value that they bring to the table is a little bit of how the the word of mouth or that kind of influence works on the people, or basically reaching out to multiple as many users as possible. Radio medium, for that matter, which is like at the topmost of the funnel, they don't know what conversion. They don't really have an attribution way, in my opinion. I mean, they just have a reach and the law of percentages, where you would have, that's where basically the brands would kind of use for. So with all these different ways of measuring, with all these different ways of, giving out some sort of value to the next consumer that you have, do you feel that a common interest is really possible in this whole ecosystem when it comes to the offerings and the consumptions?
I think that the common interests are the measurement tactics that a given marketer has at their fingertips to measure satisfaction with their products. They do this today through media metrics like clicks.
Right.
That's a common interest. And it's something that all marketers share. They clicked on this unit. And now I know that there'll be further information that I'm going to gather from this individual now that they've clicked, or they filled in a web page, they filled in this information, they called me. These actions have nothing to do with the actual segmentation of the audience, other than that's what drove them to click. And I do not think that marketers will be sharing what those segments are that are causing people to switch their insurance policy. The competition is just too high. But if they wanted to compare, we're seeing an average cost per click decrease by 20%. I think everybody knows that they're probably doing a good job somewhere. And what is it about them that they're doing that's causing this value? And so they can speak in proxies of interest that then demonstrate their growth or their decline against their target consumers. And I don't think that's ever going to change. And I don't think it's going to get more descriptive than that. And that's why we need standard measurement solutions. That's why we need things to be audited, so we can trust that if Nielsen says that this many people watched a TV show, or if my ad service is that this many people clicked on it, are there auditing bodies behind that to say that that's true? If there are, and the delta of what's the variety, excuse me, I'm having trouble saying this, the percentage, the margin of error.
Right.
If the margin of error is known, then people know, okay, fine. I know what my scope is here.
Right. And I don't think we have a good solution for that as yet, because wherever you would, whenever you put in something of this, it also has its negative impacts, because how do you really validate somebody who's really validating it? So that right. becomes like the next piece of right. the equation there. But I think what you bring up is a very good point, John. In the sense, when we have so many, the intent is true on both ends, on the topmost level of the value chain and the bottom most level of the value chain. And what all the disruptions, all the, so to speak, issues are probably because of whatever that we have in between or some misalignment. Let me put it this way. So there's some misalignment between what, different components that we have in between, which take the top level, player to the bottom most level player out there. And over the period of time, we have seen a lot of efforts and regulations kind of to ensure that we have those, structured way of getting the information from one place to the other. Do you think we have been successful so far, given the fact that we are still brooding upon how to keep our platforms and data more private, how to extend more transparency? And there have been enough talk on this. Do you feel that, there is the technology is still lagging behind in all of this, or is there a way to what are your thoughts on that?
I think the industry has been very successful in the way that they're using media metrics to provide business value to the intended recipients. Look at the value of search. Search brought a marketing line item into a cost of goods sold. You could predict how many key terms you bought to how many products you would sell. And that opened up an incredible innovative economy around product development. And you could argue we don't need all the products that are out in the marketplace, but it sure did give people the opportunity to know, do consumers want my product? And that mousetrap that search engines have made for themselves is quite powerful. One could argue, do they merit that exchange value? And we could talk about the fact that they're not paying the publishers with whom they're bringing that data in and the data results. That's a much different discussion. But I would say that thanks to that keyword ad-serving technology, that we've seen a macroeconomic benefit for many markets.
Very true. And, this is one of the things which I really have to kind of touch base upon, and I really feel that we should always touch base upon, is because we've really seen a disruptive shift in the way the data is generated, the data is consumed, and how people want to use data essentially. And that is because of the pandemic, right? We had a different way of working before pandemic hit. We had to change gears. We had to get into a different level of being digital, which continued for some time. And now that we're coming out of it, we are again in that, small scale repetitive pattern of, I want to use data. I prefer to use data. Now I probably don't, because of there's just too much of it, So again, in these sort of situations, we have seen that, technology is the one which has come to us as a savior from time to time, because the small businesses who wanted to kind of survive, they had to go digital. Technology helped them really quick. Now, there were platforms out there who kind of enabled an e-commerce website in a very, short amount of time and got the business digital. This was because somebody thought back then that there might be a way, or there might be a need where you need to do things faster, or you need to change the way what you're doing. You need real fast, in the sense you need to adapt very faster in order to survive. Can I ask your insights on this one in terms of adapting to not just the changing environment or the change which is forced onto us by something which we do not control, but the change that is forced, that we have basically brought to ourselves, and one of the examples of that is the change that we have brought by having this unlimited or unwarranted usage of data.
Well, you started the question as it relates to the pandemic, and I think there was an assumption made by the entire world, especially the economic world, that people would remain in their homes for the rest of their lives. And as a result, they would have a lot more time to be spent consuming media and buying products.
Right.
And that's no longer the case. And so the signals that we received about what do people do when they're at home and they have nothing else to do except consume media and to purchase products is very helpful for the next pandemic.
Right.
But it's not the new normal.
Right.
And I think we're seeing the impact of the folks that built for that type of pandemic-based media and normal economy to having to make changes that are impacting many, many, many employees, where they grew to an extent that they couldn't support it because we're getting back to the 2018 economy that we had.
True.
And so I think there's a lot of learnings there, as I mentioned, for the next pandemic. But to your point, I think we got a lot smarter about what type of content is really intriguing to people. How much dwell time are people willing to spend on any given content? The algorithms of TikTok were second to none. It came out of nowhere, and it's because their algorithms are more tailored to the interest of people who have the time to spend on it. Will people continue to spend that amount of time on it and provide that signal? Probably not. And there's something about the internet that I think is very, very important, that I think it was Mary Meeker said at one point, the internet always eats its young.
Yeah.
So there's always a replacement social media next gen thing that takes the consumers into its own, but it doesn't invent new consumers. And I think this is a misconception often, that it gets bigger and bigger and bigger with every new media outlet, which is not the case. TikTok is stealing consumers from Meta, from Snap in some cases, right? It's not, we didn't build all new ones, right? And Facebook stole them from Yahoo, Yahoo stole them from AOL, right? So it keeps coming, you know, but at the same time, the population, at least here in the US, only grew 10 to 15% in that same time period. But yet the number of impressions grew 5,000%. So marketers know that. And marketers, they look at the economic figures and the population statistics when they're building product to know how many of these things we can really sell to real people. And this comes back to, what are the media metrics? What are the economic metrics? And what are the people metrics? And those three things need to actually be your core signals on your dashboard to actually drive your media marketing strategy.
Yeah, and that's a very, very deep point that you mentioned, John. So I think basically what it means is we really need to have somebody who knows what is going to be relevant for people. And we also need to have a technology which is to make it interesting for the people. And by the end of the day, that marriage of technology and that knowledge kind of delivers the value to, you know, for which it is designed to. In the sense, if Instagram was just a different version of Facebook, then it would have not done what it's done right now. You know, it would have. So we have, somebody thought that, you know, having a social media, having your life opened, you know, to others, and having that visibility into others' life is something which comes as a second nature to humans. Innovatory thought. We had the technology to support it, got very famous. You know, it started way back. You know, Google probably tried that with Orkut in the late 90s. Now it has come to a point where we are having TikToks and we are having Instagrams, which are again, you know, trying to kind of get as much market share as possible. And again, the attention economy, as we spoke about, there's only a limited set of users and there's only a limited set of attention period that they have to steal from. So the combination of these three is probably going to be something vital for the industry to look into, is, you know, what I feel, and I think what you're suggesting as well. And this is going to undergo changes, as we spoke about, in the sense, you know, we reviewed some of the cases where we were doing things in one way and there's something kind of caused us to change and, you know, take a different path altogether, keeping the interest, same or, you know, a little bit more relevant, or refining that interest, relevant, so that the value that we bring to the table is incremental. And this change is going to happen. I mean, we are talking about all of these things now. 5 years down the line, we'll be talking about different set of, you know, maybe Meta can pick up again, who knows. But then we are talking about different, you know, ways of engaging with the users. We are talking about different ways of collecting relevant data and being, you know, being relevant to the users, every single time. So while the change is like the constant behind all of these transformations and disruption, I think technology as we discussed before, probably will bring us to this point again and again, and probably will help us out from this point again and again. But it will not be possible unless we have that, you know, insights and the experience and that human element that all the marketers bring to the table, you know. Is that a fair statement to make, John?
I think so. I think I would put it in the following way. The technology is a means to an end. And the clarity around the end and its purpose is where we as people need to step forth about what kind of society do we want to have? What kind of future do we want to have for our children? And based off of those questions, which only people can decide, technology can't decide that for us, we then build around to support those answers. There's an actually very, very funny statement, conversation. Somebody asked Andy Warhol, the painter, artist, this was in the late 70s. They asked him, what do you think about computers? And he said, computers are stupid. They only know the answers. And that's what we bring forth as the people in the equation, is we ask the questions and we use technology to get us the answers. And then we ask more questions. And from that, we innovate. And so did we really need to put somebody on the moon? Probably not. But what signal did it send, and what kind of technology was built, and what innovation happened on the edges? And I think that's the commons circle and circus that we're in as people, is that when we lose the capacity to ask the questions and we lose our thread about what kind of future we want for ourselves, then we don't know what technology we need. And right now, if we live in a marketer-driven capitalist economy, at least here in the United States, those questions will be, how much more money can I make? And that then requires, how much better can I know my consumer to sell them more goods and services before my competitor does?
Absolutely. And somewhere down the line, it's also going to translate into how efficient is the technology that I use.
Absolutely. And that's what drives the innovation.
Absolutely. So it's again, like you said, it's a circle and a circus that we all are into, and we will be, like, you know, for a very good amount of time from here onwards, and generations from here onwards.
Right. Exactly.
So thanks, John. That was a very enjoyable conversation for me, and I hope the audience also enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed it having it. So once again, thank you so much, John, president of Adform, which is again...